Good morning, everybody. So, since my talk is titled Survive the Apocalypse by Learning Italian, I thought I'd let you know I've never worked at the CDC. I don't know that much about apocalypse. What I do know about is something I have about 20 years experience in, which is languages. I'm a Native American, so I grew up learning English, and then I learned French in school. I learned Italian through immersion, and I'm currently learning Spanish on my smartphone. So it doesn't matter how you learn languages, I'm a big fan. My background is also in communication and media studies, so I'm always exploring new ideas on how all of these things come together, as far as education, language, and my other favorite subject more recently in my life, strategy. So in order to talk about strategy, I thought we could talk about survival, because we can all relate to it, and we're all just a little bit obsessed by it right now. Anywhere you look in the media, and all of the multiple forms of media that we have right now, you can see dramatizations, video games, books, comic books, television shows, movies, earthquakes, floods. Some of these things actually do happen, of course, especially the natural disasters. Plague, nuclear war, aliens, all of these things and tabloids. Everywhere you look, especially now more than ever, even though it's been an obsession for the human race since our inception, including the beginning of the world, we talk about the end of the world. But right now, it's really consuming our entire environment. So without this list, there's one that stands out to me as a particular favorite of ours right now, which is, of course, zombies. So since I am obsessed by language, and I am obsessed by strategy, and I know that we are all obsessed by zombies, I thought we could look through the lens of zombies and survival in a zombie apocalypse to talk about strategy and how we can develop our strategic mind through language. So first, on the media end of things, I wanted to relate it a little bit back to how does survival and these apocalyptic situations combine, other than if you're actually in an apocalyptic situation and you do need to survive. In the real world, in real time, we actually approach these subjects and get obsessed by them because we're trying to survive right now. This little chart will show you just movie production. That's the only media that it represents, from the early stages of movie making till the present time. And over this past almost century, there's been some different spikes in zombie movie making, but you can see especially more recently. Nonetheless, every time there's a spike, sociologists have correlated it to other extreme stressful and anxiety-inducing societal things, like, for example, the big spike that you see there was right around at the time of the Iraq War. So sometimes it might have to do with other diseases and whatnot. And so we use zombies, among other things, but in this case, zombies, cathartically, to deal with that kind of anxiety and our fear. So to simplify all of that, to move on to the next phase of the talk, what I've basically surmised is that the way we try to deal with fear the most is by scaring ourselves even more. And aside from being fearful, what we want to do is be prepared. So there's a whole other movement right now. You'll see, I don't know if any of you are familiar, but on YouTube, cable TV, reality television shows, we are terming people preppers. Anybody familiar with preppers? Yeah, okay. So it's not just my obsession, they are pervasive as I perceive. Preppers basically will teach us survival skills like what to store in your pantry, how to keep water and keep it clean for a long time, how to train your family in first aid, how to create a bunker in a lost plan of land somewhere that you might buy, things that are less extreme, more extreme, how to use weaponry. Nonetheless, it all takes place on what you see on the left side of the screen here, which is what I call the tools or the usefulness side. These are all things that we need to survive. We need them. And what they really do for us is they make sure that we don't die, right? Survival actually has two components. It's not just not dying. It's surviving strategically through stress, through a stressful situation. So we need to develop that part of ourselves as well, not just stock our bug out bag, our trunk, the trunks of our cars, our basements, our bunkers, our attics, and whatever remote locations we might have set up for ourselves in the case of an apocalypse. We need to be adaptable, strategic. We need to be resourceful, rational. We need to be brave, creative. These are all things that we need to develop in ourselves constantly to live not only a good, healthy life, but a life that we're surviving very well while we're living it, before and if ever an apocalypse were to come along. So the next thing I wanted to talk about is risk. Before we talk about this slide, what I wanted to ask is if you guys wouldn't mind participating in a little personal risk assessment. Raise your hand for me, please, if you have ever gotten yourself out of a situation using tactics like running, so that would be changing jobs or moving towards something, changing your home, changing a relationship, talking through something, or maybe using violence, or allowing yourself to be hurt, money, paying your way through something. Everyone's raising their hand because we've all used different tactics in real life to survive and get through stressful situations, or when we need to make a change and move on to something else. In business, we do things a little like this. This is a very simple version. It can become very complex, but this gets the idea across. We'll do things like identify risk, you analyze risk, you monitor risk, you implement a plan, you go back around. It's cyclical. Any step can be engaged at any time. It's kind of dry and meant to be predictable and meant for long-term success. Usually it's used for things that have high stakes, monetary involvement, or other kinds of damage, like maybe you're building a bridge. You need to study all kinds of high-stakes situations for that. I don't know anyone who runs their life this way. Maybe I know one person who runs their life this way. Anyone here run their life this way? No. I've known most people to run their life this way, whether or not they're doing it consciously or not, but we hit walls, we turn right, we turn left, we go backwards. Eventually, we might come out the other end. We might stay in one corner a really long time, wonder why did we stay there so long? Well, what I realized when I became really interested in risk management is that most people, not businesses, but people, don't understand risk. We're not taught risk management at all on a personal level. We don't grow up learning about making strategic choices. We might get a script of what to do with our lives, but we don't understand why we're doing it. We might rebel, depending on your personality. We don't know why. We don't know what the end point necessarily is, or how we're going to get there, or what if something changes in the meantime. So that's where strategy comes in. When I realized that there wasn't a lot out there for people to learn about risk on a personal level, I became interested in gambling. Because gambling kind of arches the spectrum between someone obsessively trying to beat the odds at a game and understand it. So that's kind of like risk management. And then the whole other end of that spectrum is hope and trust. But hope isn't a strategy. It's not. So moving from back to front so we can get to survival, strategy, and language, I want to talk about the left side and the right side of the brain, not from a neuroscience point of view, but from a categorical point of view. You'll see some big similarities between this list and the list I showed previously. The usefulness side, what we think of as useful, tactical things that we can use functionally, and then other more contextual, imaginative, whole-minded sorts of ways of going about doing things. So if you look on the left, you'll see language. And we typically think of language as a functional thing. Human beings have this amazing gift of language, but when we learn it, not natively, but when we learn something in a school, usually, in my experience, it's been, you know, in around high school, you start learning the this functional thing. You have nouns, you have verbs, you have syntax, grammar. It's boring, not that interesting, and you don't really understand the point. And we're not really engaging in that learning situation the whole picture of the benefits of language. When you start using language and you start living language, maybe that's traveling or through work or even just through your community, because God knows every community has plenty of opportunities to speak different languages. We just may not engage in them. Some of the things that you can learn, usually not by osmosis, but in every contextual situation, gradually, as you branch out. So you learn how to say a sentence, or you learn how to read a sentence or identify words. But once you start putting them together, a simple little bit that you learn turns into something a little bit more complex and a little bit more complex, and you start seeing the world a little bit differently. You start understanding how to approach problem solving a little bit differently. And what you see here are some of those resources that you build deep in your mind that have nothing to do with actually speaking the language at hand. So you become rational, become very aware of what's going on, because you have to absorb everything to learn anything. You become very self-sufficient. Dictionaries can only do so much for you. And very adaptable, of course, which is our best human muscle that we engage in. One of my main experiences that really convinced me of language being a really good teacher of strategy and survival is I had the opportunity to teach for a year in Italy, three-year-old Italians in immersion-style English for a year. So this means that for a good portion of their day, 5 days a week, these three-year-olds, who were just barely getting a handle on their own language, but we're all about comfort, right, at this age. Everything is about, the world is being given to you, shown to you, just as it is. And then you get put in school, and everything's totally shaken up. You just start to think you got a handle on things, and someone's speaking a language that you don't even understand. So, of course, screaming kids. It developed over the year. It was a massive success. I couldn't be prouder of that experience. I witnessed in these little children their total vulnerability, because young children are not afraid to be vulnerable. I witnessed their ability to really just look outside of themselves, because they don't have a strong identity built yet, where we feel we can only do things one way. There only is one way, right? So as you learn, and I've experienced this myself, I only started learning languages in junior high school and beyond, but what I did learn over 20 years of doing so is those skills that I developed were very similar to what they were doing, but in a very natural, sort of easy way. Even if it was a little bit forced upon them, they were very welcoming of it. And I saw those differences. So the next thing I wanted to bring back around to this whole survival aspect is, what do we expect from survival? Do we expect just adaptation, which is our great skill? Do we expect to be able to pick something up and make it work for us? Do we expect to just not die? What do we want when we're obsessing over things like the zombie apocalypse? Do we just want some catharsis, some comfort? I think deeply we want to make sure that we're going to get through it, whatever it is in our present life. We're going to move through each and everything that we encounter. And so when we think of things like human evolution, it's now. Your evolution is now, every single day. We're not just part of a broad evolution. You're part of your individual evolution. It's never too late to start developing those strategic skills to make sure that you move forward in your life in a way that will get you exactly where you want to go. And it happens fast when you start thinking that way. When you're not going through the labyrinth and figuring out and taking 2 years to do something that you could do in 6 months just because you thought about it a little bit more, or because your strategic muscles were stronger. So we all know, let's be honest, that I didn't really come here to talk about zombies. We know this. I'm not a zombie expert, and there are many people who are. Though I thought it was a great way to get your attention, because I do think survival and strategy are very intertwined. And I think language and strategy are very intertwined. So I think that in some way or another, we can use language to survive the apocalypse. What I want to finish with on for this talk with you is, when you learn a language, you learn a skill, you learn something that maybe you can use. If you're telling someone that you're going to start learning Mandarin or maybe Spanish, what will they say? Great. That's good. You know why? Because they perceive it as useful. If you tell someone that you're going to start learning Turkish or Dutch or Italian, they ask why. Because it doesn't seem like it's that useful. It doesn't seem like you might get very little opportunity to use it, and gosh, that's a lot of effort. But it doesn't matter what language you learn. It just matters that you use it, that you're passionate about it, and that you really engage with it completely. Learning languages doesn't just expand the amount of people you can talk to. It completely transforms you.